and how you look all has great importance. It's as much as importance, if not more, than if you're at a job interview. It's important when you say the name Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, however you pronounce it, or whether you spell out the letters, to bow. When we say Kadosh, we go on tippy toes. Because when the angels in heaven all cry Kadosh, 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 they extend themselves to their full height. And we do our best to imitate the way of the angelic host. That's why we pray three times a day. It's said that the angels wait for man to actually begin the prayer service. So when we're late for prayer, we're holding up the prayer service that cyclically goes all around the world, and we all join in the one chorus of returning praise to Yahweh, which goes up and is woven into a crown of prayers for the Heavenly Father. Not that he's deficient of anything and requires anything from us, but he chooses to adorn himself with a crown that is actually intertwined with the tears and the sincerity of all our prayers. Somebody says, "Oh, it doesn't matter about body language." You say to them, "Well, tell that to Moshe when he stood overlooking the battle between the Israelites and the Amalekite, the body language doesn't matter." You betcha it matters. As soon as those arms went down, the Amalekite began to beat the snot out of our ancestors. As soon as those arms went back up, we began to beat the snot out of the Amalekites. Until the arms remained up and were helped and supported by fellow Israelites, and then we killed them down to the very last man. I think body language matters. There are times when we should be seated low to the ground. There's times when we should be standing still. There's times when we should be bowing. There's times when we should be raising on tippy toes. There are times we should have our head bowed, be seated, or even moving vigorously. Body position is as critical in prayer as anything that we would do. A sportsman positioning himself in the right way to participate in archery, even when we swim. I watch my daughter learn to swim. And her body has to be in a certain way to do the different styles of swimming if you want to achieve them well without hurting yourself or drowning in the process. Psalm 143, verse 2. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise Yahweh. Psalm 143, 2. When is the Aaronic blessing delivered? When is it delivered? We just had it today. At what point of the day is it delivered? At the end. Can you imagine going along to a football match and the team's supporters are going berserk all the way through the game? Yay! Yeah, go the Dragons! Right? And the Dragons win. The Dragons win. And they go in, bang! And all the fans, and then the full-time whistle goes, and all the fans just go, yay, yay, yay. That doesn't happen. They go even worse, don't they? They go even more animated. So if you think we're going to have our arms raised in the sanctuary, and then when we come to the crescendo, to the grand finale, we're going to be like this. We've got another thing coming, don't you? Now Solomon finished offering all the prayer and plea to Adonai, and he rose from before the altar of Adonai, where he had knelt with hands outstretched toward Hashemayim. 1 Kings 8:54. And Ezra blessed Adonai, the great Elohim, and all the peoples answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshipped Adonai with their faces to the ground. Nehemiah 8:6. 1 Thessalonians 2:8. I desire then that in every place men should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarreling. Lifting hands is a part of spiritual warfare. By having your hands raised, and I can see people in this fellowship from one Sabbath to the next who value importance of what their arms and hands and their heads are doing at various times during the liturgy. The hands come up as an antenna during the liturgy when a part of the liturgy comes to a person that means a lot to them. And you can see it. I can tell you that this particular person, that particular part of the liturgy, means something very personal to them because the arms go up or the hand goes out. Yes?
You know where these putting hands together came from? Because
I'm going to get to it. Yeah, I wasn't either. I wasn't either. It was from Star Trek. It was from Star Trek vehicle. There you go. No, it wasn't from Star Trek. I hope to. Well, in actuality, last week we looked at the triangle at a little bit of length, and we found that it was the custom of the priests when they administered the Aaronic blessing to bring their hands up in the shape of a shin. So each individual hand movement like this, I'm going a bit ahead of myself, but hey, it's all right, we can go over it again. Each individual hand is the shape of a shin. Now, when you bring them together, it makes one big shin. Yeah? And it was the custom to bring it up into this manner and have the fingers still parted there. And so making the triangle, the dalit. Now, some Jewish communities have the top end of the dalit open, showing that there is no capstone there, no headstone yet. Some have the dalit completely closed. Some will put up the dalit in front of the right eye. The right eye symbolizes mercy, the left eye symbolizes judgment, and they would peer through the stone the builders reject, which is Yeshua. And so to answer your question, the reason why the triangle came about is because it was a representation of Yeshua, which every good thing comes down and flows through the Son. And the stone that these builders rejected was that central top or cornerstone.
But my question was about something else, about this Catholic way.
I'll show you something. I've got... that's all right. I like the enthusiasm. It's all good. In Leonard Nimoy's autobiography, I Am Not Spock, Nimoy wrote that he based the Vulcan salute, which we can see up here on the slide, on the priestly blessing performed by Jewish Kohanim with both hands thumb to thumb in the same position, representing the Hebrew letter Shin. Then we can see there, which has three upward strokes similar to the position of the thumb and the fingers in the salute. The letter Shin here stands for El Shaddai, meaning Mighty One of Spirits, as well as for the Shekinah and Shalom. Nehemiah wrote that when he was a child, his grandmother would take him to an Orthodox synagogue, and he's Jewish, by the way, as Sister Rhea said, where he saw the blessing performed and he was impressed by it and added the hand gesture to his character, which was half Vulcan. I didn't know that. I thought he was fully Vulcan. There you go. You can tell I'm not a trackie. I have. Oh, I've got a lot of catching up to do. He performed the Aaronic blessing that he saw performed in synagogues when he was growing up. This format is similar to the common Middle Eastern greetings Salam Aleichem, which is Arabic, and Shalom Aleichem in Hebrew, meaning peace be upon you, and its reply, upon you be peace. And what was his catch cry when his character would lift up his hand like that? Live long and prosper. So even the words accompanying the hand gesture was a Vulcan's type of Aaronic blessing in the form of a greeting. There are many, many, many variations to the hand gesture that you will see when the Aaronic blessing is given. Now, I've already established that when somebody gives something somebody, or I don't know if I've established it, I'll talk about it now. When somebody gives somebody something, a hand goes outstretched. So if I want to give Vikul a blessing, I will outstretch my arms toward him and give him that blessing, or to the community. My arms will go outstretched toward the community to show Yahweh that I'm dispensing, I'm prepared to dispense whatever blessings he can bestow upon the community or an individual at large. So it's just as simple as that. Now, why isn't it specifically found in the Torah? Well, we've seen that it is actually found in the Scripture, the commandment to raise holy hands. But why isn't it not something that's found in Scripture? Well, my answer to that is, what if you've got no arms? What if you've got one arm? What if you're bound? Yeah? It's going to be a little bit hard for you, not necessarily to administer an Aaronic blessing. I'm sure they'd be able to have somebody more appropriate to do it with arms for the community to do the bracha, but to just do a blessing in general. If you've got able-bodied arms, the arms will go forward toward the object that which you're blessing. In regards to the hand gestures, through process of deductive reasoning and knowing that the three pyramids, the chief one being minus its capstone, because Yeshua is our capstone, the blessing, the most powerful blessing in all of Scripture, which the Scripture itself attests to, comes by way of King Messiah represented as the rock, that chief upper cornerstone. And if you're from a Sephardic community, you'll do the bracha with the fingers outstretched like that. So there will be no shin, there will be no capstone, there will be no eye of mercy. Various other communities, the Chabad community will do the eye in the triangle there, which is depicted there. Most Jewish communities, Orthodox communities, Ashkenazi, will do variants of these ones here, whether the thumbs touch at the knuckle or at the tip of the knuckle, or just here you've got two hands that go up as two separate shins. Now listen, my if you're saying, well, which one's right? I don't know. I don't know which one's right. I only will do one as personal preference, and I'll personally, because I'm a follower of King Messiah Yeshua, I will do the eye in the triangle. Because I follow King Messiah Yeshua, and he is my stone that the builders rejected. And he is watching us. I won't be deterred by all this Illuminati fluff and not do it just because the enemy's hijacked it. But it has happened. My triangle has gone up to my eye, and I think Richard took me aside very early on in our relationship, and he said, "Do you know that was an Illuminati symbol that you just did?" And it really put the guy off. He was really shaken up about it, and I understand that because I was a big Illuminati buff, and I'd be carrying on about the Illuminati and going, "Oh, the Illuminati's everywhere, celebrities and the rich, look at that, there's even one of Hitler doing it. Ooh, they've even got Beyonce on stage giving it a go." You can find stuff like that all over the web. And you can sit there and speculate, talk about how the enemies, you know, they call it the rock. They actually call it the rock. And it's a symbol of the few controlling the many. So the top of the triangle symbolizes the few, and the masses are down the bottom. It's a typical case of the enemy hijacking a symbol and attributing its own agenda to it, and robbing us of the purity of the original Magan, of the original Dalit.
At least one of these hands is not Jewish.
Which one? I couldn't believe that. I was about to put that on Facebook last night, but it was too late. And I was going to go, "Guys, I think I've got it all wrong. I think I've been teaching you lies, you know. Hitler's doing it, so we mustn't do it, you know." But I might put that up on Facebook as a separate. Isn't it amazing? I don't know what he's doing in that photo.
Oh, I didn't see.
Yeah, you've got Hitler giving it a go. It's Yivarech. Oh gosh, looks like he's actually saying the blessing there, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah,
all right, women. Those of you ladies who do the blessing over the candles. The blessing over the candles performed by the woman of the home, it's a self-administered Aaronic blessing. It's interesting because when you wave your hands, see here what my hands are doing? Now, you do it probably a bit differently?
No, I've been doing it
No, that's not wrong. There's various ways. Like I showed you with the different hand gestures, you can do an Aaronic blessing. If Tom got up there next week and did an Aaronic blessing like that, it'd be fine. That's Tom's preference. Now, I'm not here to tell you what's right or what's wrong. I don't know. That might be the reason. But I'm just, these are things that I'm picking up along the way. These are Torah principles that I'm finding in our body language and the things we do by tradition, largely. And so the woman is found Erev Shabbat. If they do it that way, do you do it like that, Donna? Or do you just... Yeah, Donna does it. If you slow down what you're doing, you've got this happening. If you put them out, you do it that way. Oh, yeah, the candles have gone out. You do it like that? Yeah, you make up the capstone. So she's bringing Yeshua in. And why do you do it three times? It's interesting. Why do we do it three times? We do it three times. Symbolizes the power of Yahweh's Ruach to live in our nefesh and to live in our mind, in our will, which is our Ruach, and to live in our neshama, our spirit. So each time you do it, you're asking Heavenly Father to allow His double portion of His presence to come upon all those three levels of your being. That's what happens when you die. All those three parts of you all go in different directions. It's a three-way tear when a person dies. So, where's my clicker? No wonder the enemy has made an attack on our most gracious gift from the Almighty. The Berakot Kohanim that flows through the stone, the upper cornerstone, that represents the stone the builders rejected, Yeshua HaMashiach. If you want to keep jumping at the boogeyman every time you see a triangle, be my guest, but don't you think it's time to take back the truth, undress it from its outer layer of falsehood, and claim it back in the name of King Messiah Yeshua. Don't get caught up in all the hocus pocus about vain subjects. Such people look for a devil under every rock. It's time we started to look for Torah under every rock. My hope is that whenever you see a triangle, or even you see one of these people skylarking around, making that symbol, that you will be reminded of Yahweh, His mercy in bringing Yeshua HaMashiach to us as our chief upper cornerstone that the builders rejected. It's up to you if you want to keep looking at the negatives. Be aware of the negatives so you know where not to go. But to sit there and meditate and pore over them, that's what we should be doing with the Torah. And the enemy has taken it away from this generation, but we're winning it back gradually, one person at a time, one congregation at a time, one city at a time, one nation at a time. You've just got to share what you have learnt and turn it all around, because this is bizarre. The more deeper we go into it, the more it looks bizarre. Most people know about the Illuminati. Most people know about the Eye in the Triangle now, thanks to certain people that have made it well known. Most people know the nefarious agenda of the Freemasons. Most people know that the Freemasons are up to no good. There's no question that they're up to no good. But in the kingdom to come, or at least in the Messianic era, there will be next to none of that around anymore. So if all you've been used to is sussing out the bad guy, what are you going to do when there's no more bad guy to suss out? There's ministries that are still functioning today, that are alive and well today, and the core, most core part of their ministry is to rout out the devil and talk about how the devil functions and what the wails of the devil are, what his machinations are. And that's fine, but if we don't do justice to what we're meant to be doing in our walk with Yahweh with the same finite detail, then we're just going along and we're just watching a dramatic film or looking at something that we have a gee wisdom about. The thing that we need to do, and I'm telling you all of this, those of you that are on the broadcast, is we need to look at Torah conduct at home. I was very shocked 3 or 4 weeks ago to find three people in this congregation that have been in this congregation for quite a time can't do a general blessing over our main meal. You should by now be able to say a couple of blessings in Hebrew. And that's what you need to be working on. And just little, you think, oh, that's such a little thing. No, it isn't. And if you do it in English, it's better than nothing. But don't you think you can learn to do the blessing over the washing of hands, you can learn to do the blessing over the food, and learn it in Hebrew. It's a couple of lines. You can get it on a CD or a USB, and you can do it. Now, there's some people here that might never want to do it, and that's fine. But these might be people that definitely have an air about them that they would probably have known that, and I was shocked to find that they didn't. So we need to work on those things. Forget about all this garbage. This is all going to go to hell in a handbasket anyway. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Every symbol, whether it be a crucifix, comes back to the original pictographic Paleo-Hebrew language. The cross, that T shape, was originally a Hebrew letter, as is all the letters used by the occult and by the Christian world and whatever other sect. But it's important that we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. We don't jump at shadows anymore. You're the biggest guy in the room. The buck stops with you. You serve the most supreme Elohim. Your ancestor Elijah made a spectacle of all the worshippers and followers of Baal, the Canaanite deity, whose father came and created mankind and then retired and put the functioning of his so-called creation in the hands of his sub-deities. Our heavenly father wasn't an Elohim that turned up onto a beach, made a castle in the sand, and then went home, ladies and gentlemen. He thoughtfully made creation. He thoughtfully made everything. And he's here with us. He didn't just make it and get bored of it and leave and put somebody else of lesser degree in charge. Never before, when Israelite came to the fore, was there a nation that worshipped an Elohim that was as unique as Yahweh. It put a lot of the nations off. They couldn't get their head around what was the type of Elohim that the nation of Israel followed. When a Roman centurion or Roman citizen would go up to an Israelite, they would come up to them and they'd say, "What gods do you worship?" And they'd pause, and in the time they paused, they would pull out idols from their jacket and they would show the Israelites, usually Jews, these gods that they worship that they carry around with them in their jackets. And then a Jew would finally say, "I don't carry around such idols of gods." And so, according to the Roman perspective, the Jews were known as the first atheists, because they didn't carry around images of their Elohim. It's strange. It doesn't follow the course of the rest of the world. Look at all the other religions that exist, and they all look like sisters of one another and brothers of one another. The true faith of Yahweh, whether it be played out in Orthodox Judaism correctly, or whether it be played out in a Nazarene Israelite's walk in acknowledging Yeshua as the living Torah, is unique on the face of the earth, and there is nothing like it. Nothing like it whatsoever. And we're blessed to be a part of this, because we're going to be the forerunners of a big flow-on effect of thousands and thousands of people being added to the communities. Now is the time to be trained up in the little things, because what does Luke say? Somebody is entrusted with very few things will receive few blows if they are disobedient. And somebody who's entrusted with much will receive many blows. So it's up to you. You want to be somebody entrusted with few things? That's fine. Be a person that walks in a way where you're a person that's simple in your way. That's fine. It's up to you, you know. But if you want to be somebody that begins to have weight in what you do, make sure you're well-rounded. You don't want to be progressing so far high in one aspect of your walk with Yahweh and another one be left wanting. You've got to bring everything up to par where you are. You might be great at reading Hebrew. You might be lousy at something else. Whatever the thing that you're lousy at, you need to commit time and energy to get that up on par, perhaps with a knowledge of Hebrew or perhaps with a knowledge of history or eschatology, whatever it might be. Just don't leave anything behind. You know where you fall short. I don't know where a lot of you are falling short. You know, so you're the best person to diagnose what it is you think you need. to work on. But I tell you, when we all get together and all of you have different abilities and gifts, then we all come together as a single body, a single man before Yahweh, and it's a good thing to see. Thanks, everybody, for tuning into this series and coming along and checking out the truth about the eye and the triangle. If there's any questions, I'm happy to take any now. And any later on, anybody that's online, if they want to type a question in there, feel free to fire it at me and I'll do my best to answer it. Yes, Ree?
You just went through the details of the erotic person in the word Baraka, drawing your spiritual energy and what that means with David. Yes. Can you want the time of the day, we're saying Baruch HaTayahu. We're saying it back to him. Now, what exactly in that context do you mean?
Well, that's basically your strength in your vessel. When you're saying it back to him and you're acknowledging him with all sincerity that you're thankful that you've got nice clothes on, that you're thankful that you're allowed to wear nice jewelry, and that you're thankful that you've got things that you need for you to smell nice, and you've got a running shower, you've got a job, you've got a car that actually works. If you're acknowledging all these things before Yahweh, it's a very good question, right? And you're constantly acknowledging Yahweh by blessing him, that is actually strengthening your vessel. So when you come here on Shabbat, whether you're tuning in, because you guys are doing your best you can to be as much as you can with where you are geographically, I believe that with all my heart. When you receive the Aaronic blessing, the bracha that comes through our humble brother Tom, then you will be able to actually hold that cup of blessings more sturdily by walking in that way and blessing Yahweh back to him throughout the course of the week. If we're doing it with the right intent and with sincerity and things like that, because we do want to excel in our walk with Yahweh. We don't necessarily want knowledge for the sake of wanting knowledge to actually wow people with knowledge. We want to have knowledge which is actually going to change us and make us feel more peaceful inside. Because I tell you, the more you gain in knowledge, and if your maturity doesn't follow along with your attainment of knowledge, and I see it quite a lot, then there's an emptiness that grows inside you. Because the more you know what you should be doing and you're not doing, the more you're putting across to others what you know that you should be doing, elevates you in the sight of your community, but inwardly there's an emptiness there. And so we've got to make sure that no one cares what you know unless you know people know that you care about them. So your concern should be for one another, and we should have the attitude of Aaron, that we feel generous and we feel that whatever your win is, Ree, in your life, reading that testimony, it gives me joy, and I punch fists, and I go, yes. Yeah, Brooke.
The question is, so when we said Baruch HaTah Adonai,
do
we really bless our Heavenly Father, or we just admit that He is blessed? Because usually,
Good question.
When you read the Bible, actually, you see the blessing come from somebody who has bigger authority to somebody lower.
Yeah. And that's exactly why the Aaronic priesthood was given the honor of administering the Aaronic blessing, one of the most empowering blessings in all of Scripture, because it was a great responsibility to be able to draw down this blessing that had the potential to actually transform the entire community. It was said that early on in the days of Israel in the wilderness, when the Aaronic blessing was dispensed, that people would actually be jumping around and cheering, and I think in some synagogues that still occurs when the Aaronic blessing is actually done, especially if you're actually blessed enough to actually have a Kohen actually in the fellowship. See, what would happen is if Tom comes to the Aaronic blessing and we know we have a Kohen here, that Kohen will come up and give the blessing. And as I get myself organized, there is a blessing at the end of the Aaronic blessing that is said if you're a non-Kohen doing it, and if you're a Kohen doing it, you simply say Amen. But if you're a non-Kohen, you don't. There's another... You say in Hebrew, it means, may it be your will that I can do this. And whatever that is in Hebrew, that's what you're meant to say if you're a non-Kohen. But if you have a Kohen to do it, they get to just say Amen. But it is a great responsibility. Most people are able to actually bless a person, but it is the Kohenim that have the ability to be able to bless an entire community and have the potential to have an effect over an entire community. You know, you can argue, some people say, I bless you. God bless you when they say goodbye. Some people are a bit uncomfortable about that because they're lightening the fact that, you know, it's like, God bless you. Like, some people can look at that negatively. Yeah.
Because if it is, then you're not really blessing him. It's just
because
you
can't
bless
God.
Are you.
He
can
bless,
so you're just acknowledging.
You.
I think so.
Yeah.
So when you say Baruch Atah, you're not really blessing him. You're actually acknowledging
that
he's
what
blessed.
That's what
that was his question, yeah.
Exactly.
Which. You, when you say a blessing over food, when you say a blessing over newborn circumcision, you are actually doing a blessing and you're acting in a way that it's a conduit of Yahweh and bringing that blessing on that individual with that particular means. There are various types of blessings and levels of blessings. Blessing over sustenance and nutrition and food. Blessing over the well-being of somebody. A blessing before one goes on a journey. Most people, I mean, there's some people here that have a desire to live as orthodox life as they can. An orthodox person would say a wayfarer's prayer before they leave, which is a blessing is a form of prayer as well. Normally, yeah. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, or Adonai, yeah. And that's absolutely true, but it is a blessing. You are blessing Yahweh, but it is an acknowledgement that you acknowledge that Yahweh's blessed. I mean, that's the thing. Does Yahweh need a blessing? No. He doesn't need your blessing. I know we all do. Yahweh's not deficient of anything. But when we bless Yahweh, and this is what I read time and time again, that blessing joins other blessings and they're woven together as an ornament around the king's head. And he wears it gladly and it adorns him and it makes him look nice. Speaking metaphorically in the spiritual realm. And so if you want to have the adornment, know that the adornment of around the king's head, you're partly responsible for the beauty of that. It's a pretty awesome thing. We're basically, Yahweh is echad, Yahweh is one. So if we're in echad with Yahweh, we'll move in exact step with Yahweh. And so everything we do, and even the things we do that aren't in step with him, we acknowledge that they're out of step. And that's an amazing thing because that aligns even that bit of your life that was out of step with Yahweh. You do something about it and you rectify it. Are there any other questions?
Yeah, because I asked a question earlier. Like, where did the Christians get the...
This? I actually shared this not too long ago in a teaching on prayer. See my hands together like this or this? Prepare yourself for a shock. It's actually a Jewish thing, not a Christian thing. It is. You pray like this. This is actually a Jewish thing, not a Christian thing. We did cover it when we did our series on Tefillah. And I'll pull it out again. And if you probably have it in your notes. If you go back to your notes, I know you were here when we were doing the Tefillah series, when everything blew out with our father congregation in Temple, Texas. We did a series on Tefillah. It was like an emergency series we did. And I do distinctly remember I did do one teaching session. And it opened with the clasp hand. If you do a quick Google search, you'll see that Google backs up what I'm saying. So it's not a Christian thing, even though all Christianity does it. And the Jews don't do it. The Jews don't do it. Most Jews won't do it. And why? Because they've hijacked it. That's my whole point. The idea is, I'll take it and rename it, therefore you won't use it. That's the idea behind that. That's why this, you haven't probably come across people that dislike that, it's an experience that'll do a number on you. And yes, it was the oldest images we have of this symbol is used in Hindu temples. There's no argument. Yes, it was. But before that, it was two inverted Dalits. Just because the earliest known ruin depicting it belongs to a heathen doesn't mean it was originally a heathen symbol. That's lunacy. The first any pagan symbol. We looked at the Nazi symbol. It's a Tammuz. It's a T for Tammuz. But what's the Hebrew letter for the Tammuz, the T? What's the Hebrew letter? A Tav. That eluded me before. It's a Tav. The Nazi symbol is actually a form of a Tav. Just a cross. But the enemy has taken it to represent Tammuz, represent luck, in the pagan realm, and then the Nazi regime adopted it as their icon for their Third Reich. So, you know, people seem to have a problem with the cross, which has been commandeered for Tammuz, yet they have a problem with the Star of David. A lot of it is just sort of low-level subconscious anti-Semitism that some people carry around and don't realize they've got a sort of subconscious form of anti-Semitism. When people complain about call no man rabbi, that's actually a subconscious, low-level lying form of anti-Semitism. Because why do I say that? Because in the same breath, Yeshua condemns calling anyone teacher or father. And it is only that thing that's rabbi that has a cultural and racial attachment. Teacher and father don't have racial and cultural attachments. Every nation, every race has a father and a teacher. But as soon as you say the word rabbi, it, straight away you're talking about the Jewish world. And so when somebody calls into question, oh, you shouldn't be called rabbi because Yeshua said, call no man rabbi, and they're completely silent, the fact that he said, call no man teacher and call no man father, there's a problem. There's a big problem. Because later on, Shaul calls himself the father of the congregations. So that's not what Yeshua was talking about at all. He wasn't giving you a pet preference for names he didn't like. He wasn't saying, call no man teacher because I don't like the word teacher and I'm your teacher anyway. He wasn't saying, call no man father because there's only one father. He wasn't saying, call no man rabbi, master teacher, because I'm the only master teacher. He was actually teaching not to actually want to pursue these titles for the actual acknowledgement of the esteem that you will get. That's what he's actually teaching there. Call no man rabbi. Make no man your single source of supply is what he's saying. So don't allow anybody to be pursue these offices because they want to puff themselves up. You get somebody up here. Usually you get somebody leaving a congregation or doing something that's a leadership role, somebody who really doesn't want to be there. The best leader you're going to have is somebody who's really not sure whether they should lead and isn't real keen on leading. That's the best leader you should have. If you've got somebody that's massively keen on leading and barks orders and gets you to jump up and down and is full in their headspace the fact that they're a leader, then you've usually got problems. You've got somebody who's kind of likes to hear the sort of sound of their own voice. Is there any other questions?
Yeah, can I just take that slide up? It's got the
Yeah, sure. Where's my clicker?
I can tell something. You want to ask a question about this?
If vehicle has got a question. Have you got a question?
I rather wanted to share something.
Oh, yeah.
A friend of mine was on vacation in Spain, and he was visiting some church from Middle Ages, and he'd seen that on the wall and also on the, generally in few places in the church and around the church, there were like stars of the David. And he was surprised, and he asked me, what this church had to do with Jews, and I started to search the net, and actually what I've seen from the pictures he sent me, that it was not a Star of David, it was a Seal of Solomon.
Oh, it's a pentagram. It was a pentagram, five-pointed star. That's the Seal of Solomon.
Yes.
Seal of Solomon's five points. It's a five-pointed star. Because it's a man. If Seal Solomon's got a head, two arms, and the legs are like that, it's a man praising Yah. You're saying it's a six-sided one, but it's a Seal Solomon.
Six, but it's you have it probably on your talit. It's broken in some places.
Are they interlinked with each other?
Yeah, exactly. So this is the Seal of Solomon. And actually, it was used like so. It's believed that the David used this star on the shield, and his son Solomon Shlomo was using actually a seal with a modified version of this star, and the star actually then later came also to some occultic practices.
Yeah.
And was used in many ways.
You've basically got the right idea.
But and interesting thing that also it was used widely by Christianity in the Middle Ages. So that's why it's on this church.
You're right what you're saying. And it's do you want Ray, are you still going? She might want it tonight. There you go. Now, I went to the synagogue in Capernaum in Galilee, and this synagogue is actually situated behind Kepha, that's Peter's family fishing and pickle business, which is still present in the form of a ruined home, which was large enough to also serve as their fishing business. And this synagogue has is in ruins, but it's still got a lot of the walls and things there. And it's got a yeshiva off to one side, which you can still see the walls are up to about this high in many places. And there's an archway, which I'm going to show you as soon as Reece finished typing it up. And I took a photo of it, and it's an archway of this synagogue in Capernaum. And this would have been the synagogue that Yeshua preached in. There is some conjecture that the pillar that actually is there is from the 3rd or 4th century. Unbelievably, and when I was researching for the last week's teaching, I've since found that they've agreed that archway and the ruins are actually from the 2nd century. So that means that there's every chance that the ruins that you're seeing could have been from the synagogue that was there in Yeshua's day. Whether it was in Yeshua's day is kind of not, doesn't matter for what I'm trying to say. But this particular pillar, have you finished?
Yeah.
This particular pillar, and this is a photo that I took, and I've seen other people take it, and anyone who goes to Israel takes a photo of it. And over the top of the pillar, where is it? Oh, hang on, it's over here. I saw everybody, okay, where is it, part one? Over the top of the pillar, there is a Star of David and there is a pentagram. Now, if you have a look, go on the web and type in Seal of Solomon, you'll find that the Seal of Solomon, and I'm sure there's probably some stuff that support what you're saying, particularly the source that you're actually talking about, as you can see there. Now, because remember, Solomon was after David, so you had David first with the Magan David, which is the two inverted dollars, and you've got the seal of what's called the Seal of Solomon there, which is a non-inverted pentagram. So if you turn the pentagram sort of this way, you get a goat with the ears and the horns. But if you kind of keep it the way it is, with the two legs at the bottom, then it's kind of okay. And the idea is that's also a symbol of protection. So that's why in the occult world, you'll usually find a big pentagram on the ground. You won't usually find a Star of David. But you'll find a pentagram. Now, why do you find a pentagram, you don't find a David? Does somebody want to answer that? This has actually brought up something very interesting. Nobody wants to answer. The reason is because King Solomon solicited the assistance of demons to build the temple. And you think, what? Demons actually build a temple? Well, let's look at the term demon. Demon is from a Latin word. And the Hebrew word for demon is Shaddai. So when you say El Shaddai, you could actually say Mighty One of Demons. But if I got up there while we were doing the song and I said, oh, it means Mighty One of Demons, everybody would have dropped the ball. Wouldn't they? They would have gone, oh, I don't know if I should keep coming here. Now, it's what's happened since we've started to use ecclesiastical language, that is language that has a Latin source and Anglo-Saxon words that have come to be English words, we've superimposed lines of demarcation over things that were never there. We give the name angel to a Hebrew word which just means messenger. We give the name holy to a Hebrew word which just means separated. We give the name priest to a Hebrew word which means something that has a little bit more depth and breadth to it. And so in the occultic world, they go, well, okay. And there is stories where Solomon had a tussle with evil spirits. And evil spirits had the upper hand for a period of time. So that's why in the occult world, you'll get the pentagram of Solomon, or the five-pointed star, being more of a feature than you will the Star of David. Go into any New Age bookstore, though, which I'm sure you might have seen, depending on your background, and if the occult work is quite extensive, you'll have plenty of images of the Star of David. Now, if you go and have a look at the American $1 bill, if I've got it here, which I think I do, this is last week's teaching, by the way, you'll see that there's plenty of, you've got Star of David here, made up of smaller stars, and they use words like illuminate and enlighten, and when we use the word illuminate and enlighten, it's almost like we all sort of go quiet, like these are occult words, but they're not. They're words that are valid English words, but they've kind of just been seconded to the occult world, so we're kind of scared about using them. There's 13 arrows and there's 13 leaves. This represents the 13 tribes. You've got the 13 layers of pillars representing the 13 tribes. You've got the stone that the builders rejected, but it's being returned there. You've got the eye of Yahweh mentioned in a singular in one of the passages in Psalms, which I think I have here. Let me see. Because somebody said, well, my Yahweh isn't a cyclops. I think that was Barry Smith, actually, that said that. And it is true, Yahweh is not a cyclops. But by the same token, there is scriptural support mentioning that the eye of Yahweh looks down upon me. Where is it? See, there you go. There's the... Now, that's... Hey, look, there you go. Made a liar out of me. There's the actual... See the pentagram, though, in there, though? So, yeah. Sorry.
I mean, like this. You have... Oh,
it's woven. Kind of a woven, yeah. I've actually had a lady, she got really upset because I had a woven Star of David. But if I had a normal Star of David, she had no problem. It's just weird. It's all that is a little pet thing that you have. It's got neither here nor there.
This is what I read about. This is the actual seal of Solomon.
This one. Yeah, no, have another look if you can, because that's basically just linked by a weave. But
that one in the synagogue is a weave one as
well. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. So technically that one and the pillar, both of them are woven. You've got the pentagrams woven and the Star of David's woven.
This one you have also probably most of us on Talit.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I've seen it too. Yeah right. Yeah. So that's woven. That's a good spot. Is that woven?
Yes.
Yeah.
Look at it.
Yeah.
Look at it.
Yeah, but this is five arms. So
the idea, look how big that thing is. You couldn't even photograph it all. Off it, but the idea, what is the point of this whole look at the eye and the triangle? It's to when we look at the Star of David, or when we look at the Seal of Solomon, when we look at the triangle. Somebody mentioned, I think it was Brother Mark, our little menorah that we have symbolizing our congregation. It has a triangle behind it. People go, oh, there's a triangle behind it, and I think it sort of winded a couple of people, but. I don't think that would be very advantageous for the congregation to adopt that as their logo. Don't you think? I think there'll be a lot of explaining to do if we had that behind a menorah.
Yeah.
With this, you know, we'd have to draw the line there. While I'm not saying that we should, that's evil. Don't get me wrong. The Illuminati is a very real organization, and they have hijacked our symbolism. I'm not coming up here today and saying there's nothing to worry about. I'm not doing that at all. I'm just telling you that the enemy is not original. He's supplanted and he wants to steal everything that is Yahweh's, and he wants to attribute it to himself. And if we don't stand and start taking back our ground, we're going to have no ground left. You'll be turning up to Shabbat and we'll just be standing here doing one or two things that are left that we can do with a clear conscience. So we have to make other people aware of it, our children that are coming aware of it, and begin to actually take back geographically everything that is ours. There's still too many people that are jumping at shadows with things such as the Zohar and the Kabbalah. I'm not going to teach on the Kabbalah to you. I'm not going to teach on the Zohar as a core thing to you. I've never done it and I will never do it. But if there's something in the book of the Zohar that aligns with King Messiah Yeshua, I'm bringing it out. If there's something in the Talmud that happens to align with Yeshua's doctrine, I can quote it. If it doesn't align, I'm not going to quote it, and I'll tell you that that's not a good thing that it says there. You've just got to, it's like the Karaite Nehemiah Gordon does, what we were talking about, Mark. He spits out the bones and eats the meat. But perhaps he might sort of take it a bit bit further than you would do. But I still haven't worked him out. But there's no other questions. Baruch Hashem, we can have something to eat. Thanks everybody for coming out. Appreciate it. Hope everybody has a good week. Do we want to close in a word of prayer? And thank the Heavenly Father for everything that He's been doing for us and blessing us with Tom. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for the time that we've spent here today looking at your word. And we thank you that you are allowing us to be reacquainted with aspects of your Torah in terms of the pyramids, in terms of the history, the true history, and the origin of all things. And that there is a purity that pervades everything that has been taken by the enemy and is twisted. And we ask, Heavenly Father, and we pray that you allow all these things to be reclaimed by your true people. Allow us to do this lawfully, and allow us to do this in a manner that is not underhanded, but relies on you in the wholeness and fullness of your being. And we pray, Father, for your ongoing mercies and kindness and grace and protection. And we pray you bless us as we do this in the coming days, weeks, months, and years. And we pray all these things in the precious name of King Messiah Yeshua. Amen and amen. Thank you, God.
It's so conditioned by our previous way of belief that a lot of the stuff is seems almost like a choker.
Yeah, we've got to be mindful. See you guys. Thank you very much for tuning in today. I want to thank Mark for doing a great job on the audio visual. It's through Yahweh that allows us to be on air. But anyway, have a great week and Shavuot Tov. Bye now.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.